Hello, everybody, and welcome. Welcome to DANSOX. I'm Sue Jones, director of DANSOX, and it's my very, very great pleasure to introduce Professor Lynn Garafola, whom I'm sure you all know of, who is a professor of dance at Barnard College, Columbia University in New York. We're looking forward to having some relief from the election. And we're so pleased that in spite of all that, that Lynn could come and talk to us. Lynn is, of course, many, many things. She has many hats on. She's an historian, a linguist, an editor, curator of many important exhibitions. She's renowned as an international scholar in the field of dance history, and acknowledged perhaps primarily as the leading expert on the Ballets Russes, 1909 to 1929, the most influential company in 20th century theatrical dance. Her groundbreaking seminal work, Diaghilev's Ballets Russes, published in 1989, has become a Bible for most of us who study dance, students and scholars alike. Working in dance history of the late 19th and early 20th centuries, but it's also an example of how to do dance history, for which we're very grateful, Lynn. However, that's not all. Lynn's work extends way beyond this seminal work. She's published a number of edited and co-edited works and translations, including The Diaries of Marius Petipar, The Writings of André Levinson, José Limón's unfinished memoir. She's edited collections of essays on the Romantic ballet and is author of Legacies of the 20th Century and former editor of the book series Studies in Dance History. I could add to this a torrent of scholarly articles, journals, anthologies, encyclopedias, newspapers, and popular magazines. She's made many appearances on TV and radio that have resulted in written transcripts of her commentary and addresses. So we can't really underestimate the extent to which Lynn is everything in the scholarly world and in the communication of dance to people, but also a dedicated and loyal teacher and supervisor. Testimonies from former students constantly roll in. I hear about Lynn's teaching all over the place. And it reminds me of how she's helped so many young people at all points of their career. And she's, of course, founder of the Columbia University Seminar Studies in Dance, which is really a groundbreaking achievement in itself for an elite university, I would say. I'm delighted to announce that she will be graced with a 2016 Dance Magazine Award on December the 12th at the 59th annual bestowing of this award, amongst her many other accolades. Now to this evening. Lynn's current project focuses on the life and work of choreographer Bronislawa Nijinska, as we know, younger sister of Vaslav Nijinsky and member of Diaghilev's Ballets Russes, amongst other things. All of Garafola's writings have been motivated by her belief in the centrality of dance and its importance to scholarship and the cultural life of a city, a nation, and communities throughout the world, which I think is a very important thing to remember at this particular moment in history. And we thank you very much, Lynn, for coming to talk to us tonight.
Thank you so much for all being here. I want to thank Sue Jones, and I like to think that this is a continuation of many conversations we've had in New York and other places over many a glass of wine, trading ideas about dance and where things research should go and how research should be done and all kinds of other things. I'm also enormously grateful to St. Hilda's for hosting me. St. Hilda's is a college like my own, with a long history and dedication to women's education. I would have liked to have thought that that women's education, separate education, there was no need for it still. In fact, part of me agrees that we should all be mixed schools. But after the results of the election the other evening, I think we still have a long way to go in women's education and gender education. Probably the gender education is more important. But also it means that this project, which I'm doing on Nijinska, acquires a greater importance to me, in that there's a great deal of unfinished business that we've been talking about the need for the position of women or absence of women choreographers in ballet. But I think that this idea of education and where women and especially exceptional women such as Bronislawa Nijinska fall within this larger historical world, I think it becomes all that more important given what we've just seen. So on to Nijinska. In March 1913, let's reel back into history, as rehearsals for the Rite of Spring moved slowly forward, Vaslav Nijinsky, the celebrity choreographer, evicted Bronislawa Nijinska, his sister, and the ballet's chosen maiden from the cast. She had betrayed him, first by getting married, then by getting pregnant. Despite her condition, Nijinska would dance throughout the coming London and Paris seasons, sometimes appearing in two or even three ballets an evening, but not in her brother's new works. In Je and the Rite of Spring, she would remain only a shadowy presence, haunting the movement he had crafted on her, but rendered invisible by the dancer who performed it. The artistic twinship that had given rise to Afternoon of a Faun the year before was sundered by her brother's rage at the workings of her female body. In his most important work, she was there and not there, present and absent, a situation that seems, in retrospect, to sum up her own uncertain status with respect to ballet history, the ambiguous position of her works in the ballet canon, and the willful unremembering that often masks her passage through the ballet past. The marginalization of a choreographer typically has many causes. Dance is an ephemeral art, and most works fall into a limbo of non-performance within a decade of their creation. Sometimes limbo, they enter limbo a lot faster, but let's be generous. Nijinska spent the last 20 years of her life frantically trying to keep her works in repertory. However, with the collapse of most of the companies that had produced or revived them, including several of her own, all but a handful of her ballets vanished. Of course, reputation does not solely depend on the survival of a substantial body of work. Nijinsky, for instance, choreographed four ballets. I hadn't intended to go back to advance to Diaghilev at first, but I was hitting this as I was using my hands. So let's forget that he's there, as if one can. But let's go back to Nijinska. And Nijinsky and his four ballets, of which only one remains in repertory, Afternoon of a Faun. Yet all three of his pre-World War I ballets enjoy the status of masterworks in Lincoln Kirstein's Movement and Metaphor, even Je, which Nijinsky himself considered unfinished. His sister, by contrast, had a much longer and more productive career as a choreographer. In Nijinska's case, personality issues and career choices also contributed to her marginalization. Her nomadic career unfolded on three continents, leaving traces in more than a half dozen languages, including ones less accessible in the West, such as Polish, Ukrainian, and Russian. And in theaters like the Teatro Colón in Buenos Aires, outside the canonical centers of 20th century dance modernism. She was an assiduous writer, But little of what she wrote found its way into print until the posthumous publication of Early Memoirs, which in 1981, itself quite problematic in terms of its construction. She was a perfectionist who could be difficult, stubborn, and selectively deaf, an artist who insisted on going her own way. She chose to spend the last 30 years of her life in Southern California, sunny perhaps, but with a terrain that recalled the Mediterranean, but thousands of miles from New York, Paris, London, where the work of a ballet choreographer in the post-war decades chiefly lay. However, Nijinska's marginalization was not solely her own doing, let's not blame the victim, or necessarily caused by the absence of a significant body of surviving work. Discourse, what people wrote about her, almost certainly played an even greater role in determining how she was perceived from the start of her choreographic career in the West in the early 1920s until the 1960s, when the Royal Ballet's revivals of Les Biches and Les Noces began the process of solidifying her reputation as a major modernist artist. This paper argues that despite her stature, evident in the numerous companies with which she was affiliated over the decades, she seldom received her due from critics, historians, and even dancers. Again and again, her accomplishments were disparaged, her works misrepresented, and her presence, both as a dancer and a choreographer, slighted or ignored. As in 1913, she remained all too often a shadow on the sidelines of her own history, diminished by the ever-present sobriquet of Nijinsky's sister. So now we can head to here. Born in 1891, Nijinska experienced the first urge to choreograph during the early heady days of the Ballets Russes. However, Serge Diaghilev, whom Lydia Lopokova used to always call Big Serge, which I always feel is quite appropriate, the company's visionary founder, intent on developing her brother as a choreographer, refused to support her creative ambitions. Thus, it was not until she left the company and was physically separated, both from her father and from Diaghilev, that she choreographed her first dances. Returning to St. Petersburg on the eve of World War I, she spent the next 7 years in Russia, in Kiev, where she moved in 1904, I should be saying in, we can say in Kiev, the Ukrainians say Kiev, but it seems always so wrong to me, but I'm not Ukrainian speaking. In Kiev, where she moved in 1915, she experienced the transformative power of the revolution and remade herself as an artist of the avant-garde. Here she opened her own studio, and over, for those of you who read Russian, on the left is the draft copy for an announcement, and trained her first company of dancers in an atmosphere of utopian possibility and intense creative exploration. She worked with painters like Vadim Meller at the cutting edge of the constructivist avant-garde, and with theater directors such as Les Courbes, challenging the conventions of the dramatic stage. She created solos, group dances, and several abstract works, and presented her first full evenings of choreography. This is some more Meller paintings, designs. She taught in studios identified with the artistic left and wrote a treatise on performance called Movement and Action. In Kiev, of course, that was never published. In Kiev, she made the formal and theoretical breakthroughs that culminated in Les Noces, her groundbreaking, now classic work, produced in 1923 by the Ballets Russes. In 1920, word of her brother's mental illness reached her, along with her sister-in-law Romola's plea that she join him. Nijinska dithered for a year before emigrating, unwilling, as her diary makes clear, to abandon all that she had achieved in Kiev, her studio, her dancers, her choreography, her community, her place in the emerging Soviet avant-garde. In Western Europe, she joined the huge swell of refugees from the better classes of Tsarist Russia who had fled the Red Army, peasant uprisings, and the seizure of private property. Most were rabidly anti-Soviet, culturally as well as politically, especially, and identified modernism, especially in its constructivist and semi-abstract guises, with the hated Bolshevik regime. In the years to come, Nijinska would seldom refer to her transformative experiences in revolutionary Russia, although she preserved dozens of letters from former students and friends, initially yearned to return, and made notes for a memoir of the period that she never wrote. Penniless and with two children and an elderly mother to support, Nijinska rejoined the Ballets Russes in 1921. Diaghilev was between choreographers and welcomed her with open arms. But she was torn. On the one hand, anything was better than dancing at Vienna's Moulin Rouge cabaret, however close this may have been to the sanatorium where Vaclav was hospitalized and however much she needed the income. In fact, she actually never spoke of the Moulin Rouge episode or even mentioned it in her autobiographical notes, no doubt viewing it as a sign of personal failure and source of shame. In fact, I only stumbled on it by accident when I was running the Nijinsky name through an Austrian newspaper. On the other hand, she was unsure whether Diaghilev would support her creative explorations, which she was determined to pursue. It turned out that he wasn't interested in her Kiev dances. As she ruefully commented in an unpublished essay, everything he produced had to be his own idea. In London, where the company was headquartered, she set to work on a project light years away from the Rite of Spring and revolutionary Russia, the first major production of The Sleeping Beauty outside Russia. She re-choreographed some of the fairy tales and a number of other dances in faux petit-pas style, made cuts that Diaghilev insisted upon, and drilled the company. Quote, "I'm delighted to tell you," Diaghilev wrote to the composer Francis Poulenc after the ballet opened, "that I now have an admirable new ballet master, La Nijinska, Nijinsky's sister, who works wonders." The Sleeping Princess, as Diaghilev renamed the ballet, was a financial flop. And Diaghilev, with creditors at his heels, headed for Paris even before the curtain fell on the last performance. Others might have thrown in the towel. But with Nijinska at his side, he was invigorated and now set about re-energizing the Ballets Russes, changing its artistic course, and fashioning a new repertory. In 1922, the Ballets Russes played back-to-back seasons at the Opera and the Théâtre Mogador. Nijinska was everywhere, dancing two, if not three, different ballets at every performance. 31 years old, she was at the height of her physical powers, an arresting and dynamic performer, immensely versatile, who, like her brother, seemed to don a new personality with every role. She danced everything that summer, as if to prove that, like her brother, she was not only indispensable, but also a star in her own right, worthy of Diaghilev's support of her own choreographic ambitions. She danced all her own roles, along with several new ones, including The Chosen Maiden, ironically, in Leonid Massine's version of The Rite of Spring, which had replaced her brother's. There, one thinks of all kinds of palimpsests. A role initially choreographed on her, which someone else had danced because she had gotten pregnant, and then another ballet that had replaced her her brother's, and she's dancing that. But what was she really dancing? Was she dancing only Massine's version, or was she dancing maybe a little bit of her brother's version? Did that also seep in? Who knew? She also danced half a dozen male roles, including her brothers in Afternoon of a Faun, which you see in this Larionov drawing. This is movement that Nijinsky had originally sketched on her. Most of the critics raved. One who didn't was Andrei Levinson. Violently anti-Soviet, this is, I believe, a Jean Cocteau drawing. It certainly has some of Cocteau's elements. However, I just found it in Nijinska's archives at the Library of Congress in Washington. He violently anti-Soviet. He had emigrated from Russia in 1921, and with his vast erudition, fluent French, and long experience as a dance critic, quickly found a place writing for the influential performing arts daily, Commedia. Levinson hated modernism and had long dedicated himself to defending what he called the old ballet, exemplified by the works of Petipan. He also loathed anything that in his view smacked of Bolshevism, and this included Les Noces, probably the greatest ballet of the 1920s. Sung as well as danced, Les Noces is a stylized enactment of a Russian peasant wedding. It has no story. The music by Stravinsky is spare, the costumes by Natalia Goncharova plain, the choreography stark. Les Noces struck a personal chord in Nijinska, evident in a memoir written decades after the ballet's premiere. Quote, I saw a dramatic quality in the fate of the bride and groom, since there is no question of mutuality of feelings. The young girl knows nothing about her future family, nor what lies in store for her. The soul of the innocent is in disarray. She is bidding goodbye to her carefree youth and to her loving mother. For his part, the young groom cannot imagine what life will bring him close to this young girl. How can such souls rejoice during their wedding ceremonies? And in fact, many French critics said, well, if you, those who were perhaps a little less serious than Levinson, whom I will quote at length, said, well, if you saw this ballet, you'd never get married. No one would ever get married. But in any way, that was not what Levinson saw either. Writing in a Russian emigre publication, he attacked the work and its choreographer with venom, making clear his political bias. Quote, the style of, now this remember is to a Russian emigre audience, the style of Madame Nijinskaya is connected with the rhythmic practice of Dalcroze, untrue, which was born at the same time as the delirious ideology of the Soviet mass theater, a reference to works such as The Storming of the Winter Palace, directed by Nikolai Yevrenov, when thousands reenacted a dramatic incident from the early annals of the revolution. Continued Levinson, it is a method of theatricalization of life, in quotes, which allows an entire Red Army division to be involved in the show as well as crowds of working class people. Elementary rhythm, performers without personality, automatized motions, the so-called biomechanics of Meyerhold, make such choreography look like machinery, mechanical, utilitarian, industrial. It is electrification applied to ballet. Levinson's reviews in Commedia were even more vicious. Mademoiselle Nijinska, he wrote a few days after the premiere, makes use of certain movements from everyday life, duly stylized, as well as steps lifted from the ballet class and others from Russian popular dance. But pedantic and stubborn vampire, she sucks out all the blood and all the life while keeping an empty form. 2 days later, he devoted most of his weekly column to a review of Diaghilev's extraordinary one-week season, concluding with a bruising personal attack on Nijinska. A soloist much appreciated by the Imperial Theaters, Diaghilev's makeshift ballet mistress was noticed for her agility and musicality in Carnival. Then she replaced Karsavina in Petrushka, making the best of her naturally strange face and exaggerating the burlesque side of the character. Last year, we saw her take the place with a casualness that borders on impiety of her illustrious brother in Fawn. By the way, he didn't say anything about impiety in his original review, but that's... A mediocre, vigorous performer, a good musician, a dancer inclined to the grotesque because of her natural shortcomings, a vivid mind but hysterical and tense in her delivery. Having passed through the collectivist reveries of the Soviets and Swiss theories of physical culture, that's another reference to Dalcroze, who is obviously another bête noire of Levinson. This is the artist to whom Diaghilev has entrusted the fate of his, in italics, Ballets Russes. For Levinson, gender and political prejudice reinforced one another. Nijinska's grotesque body was infected with the virus of Bolshevism. Time did not soften Levinson. As late as 1931, that's 8 years later, in a review of Etude, a plotless work to the music of Bach, he was slinging the B word at her. Quote, in Madame Nijinska's aesthetic, he wrote in Candide, there is something impersonal, inhuman, and tyrannical that reveals collectivist discipline, the Bolshevist chain gang. If I am not mistaken, you knew perfectly well what he's about to say. Madame Nijinska was in Russia in 1918 or 1919, those terrible years, at the head of a dance company. She has kept its imprint. The exercises that she imposes on her dancers always recall forced labor, end quote. He definitely had a way with words. Levinson was not alone in viewing Nijinska's unfeminine appearance with distaste. Poor Bronislawa had no luck with Diaghilev, Stravinsky told Robert Kraft. Her sex, looks, and name were against her. Her face was bony and interesting instead of doll-like, and she looked like her brother, was even shaped like him. It pained Diaghilev that this person who dared look like Nijinsky was a woman. A remark that echoes the feminist scholar Christine Battersby's contention that, quote, a man with genius was like a woman, but was not a woman. Indeed, Diaghilev's view of the ballerina as an icon of feminine beauty remained highly traditional, despite his transformation of her male counterpart. He told Nijinska to dye her hair red and begged her to dress more like a ballerina. But Nijinska refused the masquerade of a glamour makeover. She was an artist, even something of a blue stocking. In revolutionary Kiev, she discarded the outer trappings of femininity, an Amazon of the avant-garde. She dressed with the plainness of a proletarian. I am not a second-rate ballerina, she wrote to Diaghilev in 1921. But, she added, Nijinska is an exceptional talent. In the range of roles she danced, in her willingness to discard what queer theorist Judith Halberstam calls femininity and its accessories, Nijinska had become an early model of Halberstam's concept of feminine masculinity, despite being a heterosexual woman in an art identified with femininity. This masculinity, coupled with her obvious gifts, disconcerted members of Diaghilev's inner circle. The poet Jean Cocteau, a company intimate since 1909, clearly resented her, jealous perhaps of her choreographic gift, something that he certainly envied, and its sway over Diaghilev. He spoke grudgingly of her accomplishments, denying her agency as a choreographer and intellectual awareness as an artist, while portraying her verbally and visually as a female grotesque. Thus, in a book about Les Biches, and this comes from that book about Les Biches, which had music by Poulenc and designs by Marie Laurencin, he wrote, Madame Nijinska lives shut up in her work. She never stops. Scarcely does she pause to do her hair or fasten her dress. By dint of jumping and pirouetting and working her muscles, she ceases to be a worker and becomes a tool. Looking at her sturdy legs, her hair, her angel eyes, one admires her as one would a pickaxe or a carpenter's plane. But her brother's blood runs in her veins, a blood that has wings. She does not try to discover what there is at the back of Poulenc or Laurencin. She is guided by intuition. Without the slightest calculation, and by simply obeying the rhythm and the exigencies of the frame she has to fill, she is about to create a masterpiece, the fête galante of her time. Maimed yet phallic, Nijinska was a woman who had to be put in her place. Now, Poulenc, the composer of Les Biches, viewed Nijinska's contribution quite differently, Writing to Diaghilev at one point, he could barely contain his excitement. "Highness, you cannot imagine what you have missed for the last 2 days. When Vera Nemchinova's dance is finished," she was the girl in blue, and what a marvel, "they start the game. I must say that as madness, it surpasses anything one could imagine. Nijinska is a genius. Listen to this. Having decided that the sofa is a star, she is making it dance throughout the game." And I think some of you, this is actually where Poulenc walked into the rehearsals, the rehearsal of this ballet, and this is what he saw. So he was quite excited when he wrote to Highness. In 1925, Nijinska left the Ballets Russes and embarked on a career as a freelance choreographer. At great personal expense, she formed two short-lived companies, choreographing for them some of her most personal works. Their failure left her saddled with debts, forcing her to take jobs that involved long separations from her family. She spent several seasons at the Teatro Colón in Buenos Aires, where she staged, as you can see, Constant Lambert's Pomona. That's where it had its premiere. And she at the Colón, she contributed to the professionalization of the young ballet company, and through his stagings of Diaghilev repertory, gave the Colón a modernist profile. She collaborated with several Russian emigre ensembles, including the Opéra Russe à Paris, which we'll return to a little later, and the Ida Rubinstein Company, which she welded into both a professional ensemble and a personal creative instrument. You might, those of you who know Frederick Ashton, will recognize him as the young man looking down at what seemed to be his knees, his knobbly knees there. That's Ashton. In the 1930s, as London replaced Paris as Europe's ballet performance and publishing capital, she crossed the channel, staging new and old works for the Marco Vidolin Ballet and for the Ballets Russes company headed by Colonel de Bazile. Nijinska did not fare well under the new regime. In the decades since she had left the Diaghilev company, she had lost touch with developments outside the Paris dance world, from Massine's semi-plotless symphonic works to the thriving phenomenon of British ballet. She spoke no English, and thus lacked access both to the growing ballet literature in that language and to the authors, editors, and critics who produced it. Of these, none was as prolific as Arnold Haskell. An ardent balletomane, infatuated with everything Russian, he wrote two of the most influential books on ballet of the 1930s. The first, Balletomania, a whirlwind tour of the author's obsession, his word, with ballet, came out in 1934 and stayed in print for decades. Haskell doesn't actually ignore Nijinska. In fact, he calls Les Noces a landmark, Les Biches the most perfect of all the, quote, decadent ballets, and several of the works she choreographed for Ida Rubinstein near masterpieces. But she's missing from his chapter on Diaghilev's choreographers, an all-boy gang of four, Fokine, Massine, Balanchine, and Nijinsky. And the one paragraph he devotes to her elsewhere damns even as it praises. Nijinska's whole influence on dancing has been of first-class importance. The only successful woman choreographer in history, not quite, obviously an exaggeration, great sister of a great brother, she has understood the systematic development of the male dancer. Dolin owes much to her and pays constant tribute to her inspiration. As a dancer, she has few equals. She's apart from ordinary standards. She has much of the strength and elevation of her brother, his own particular attack. She's also the only ugly dancer to find fame, ugly, but never in any sense plain. Haskell takes a similar tack in his equally influential biography of Diaghilev, which was published in 1935. Once again, he doesn't entirely ignore her. For instance, he tells us that Diaghilev's admiration of Nijinska was so great that he said, "If I had a daughter, I would like one with her gifts." But there's no real discussion of those gifts or of Nijinska's aesthetics generally. For Haskell, even her best ballets, apart from Les Noces, belong to the era of Diaghilev's quest for lost youth, an era associated by the author with decadence and snobisme. With Haskell, the theme of ugliness entered the British discourse on Nijinska. In an Anatomy of Ballet published in 1953, Fernau Hall, it gets stuck again and again on her looks. For example, Diaghilev did not want to include her in the company which he took to Paris because of her peculiar features. Mariinsky ballerinas were never expected to be conventionally peculiar, conventionally beautiful. But Nijinska's face was exceptionally strange. Another example. She had a hard time at first in the company, for her peculiar face made her unsuitable for straight parts in relatively conventional ballets. She came into her own with Petrushka, for in this ballet her features were perfectly acceptable. And again, Nijinsky gave her a small part in Fawn. Her face was ideal for expressionist ballets. One could go on and on. The fact that none of these assertions happens to be true is of a piece with the rest of the chapter, in which inaccuracies abound and sources are unacknowledged. For Hall, even more than Haskell, Nijinska's body is fair game, something to make free with and discursively violate. Why this sense of entitlement? Because she lived in California and lacked a local London sponsor? Because she was a woman, an old woman? The history of ballet is strewn with men, dancers as well as choreographers, who fell short of the princely ideal. Here, for example, is Fokine as a balding 50-year-old in 1931. He's with Vera, his wife. However, nobody talks about their looks as if they offended public taste. Was it because Nijinska's looks, viewed from the perspective of a man, upset the gender apple cart? A.V. Cotton, in A Prejudice for Ballet, published in 1938, ignores her looks, but belittles her achievement in other ways. For example, he begins his discussion of the Markova Dolan 1937 revival of La Bien-Aimée, originally choreographed for the Ida Rubinstein Company 9 years before, and performed by that company in London in 1931, by referring to the shock that the ballet was yet another usage of the artist seeks and finds inspiration formula, adequately dealt with by Ashton sometime before, actually only the year before in Apparitions, and one had hoped finally successfully treated and disposed of in Massine's Blood and Whirlwind idiom of Symphonie Fantastique, also choreographed in 1936. Cotton added that it was, quote, a regrettable incident or regrettable oversight on somebody's part that the score included a Liszt fragment already familiar in a different dancing context, an episode from Ashton's ballet on the identical theme. Now, given that Ashton had danced in the original 1928 production, surely he was the one doing the creative borrowing, not Nijinska, as Cotton implies. Ashton himself made no secret of his admiration for Nijinska and never denied her influence on his work. Now, some women became her champions. Let's have a few champions. The American expatriate theater critic Florence Gilliam in the 1920s, the English ballet critic Carol Brahms in the 1930s, the Los Angeles Times arts critic Isabel Morse Jones in the 1940s, and the French dance historian Françoise Rice in the 1950s, all wrote sensitively and perceptively about Nijinska's work. However, in Dance Magazine's September 1954 roundup of Ballet Russe personalities that coincided with Richard Buckle's Diaghilev exhibition in Edinburgh, the dance writer Lillian Moore simply erased Nijinska from the list of Ballet Russe choreographers. Maybe she was looking at Balletomania. Even though 16 years before, she had hailed Nijinska's brilliant career as a dancer and choreographer. Yet in the 1950s, Nijinska was not only living in the US, but still active there as a choreographer. Of all the women critics who wrote about her only over the years, only Arlene Croce, however, seems to have used Nijinska's physicality to diminish her. This is Nijinska at the very end of her life. I met Nijinska once, began Croce's obituary of the choreographer in Ballet Review, 3 years ago when she was 78, a woman no more than 4'10" tall who looked like a troll or an elephant carved in ivory. She had perfectly square feet, like an elephant's, and wore ankle strap shoes. Her earlobes were distended by dangle earrings. Well, she's not wearing any earrings there. The face lit by mongoloid eyes and the third slit of a mouth with its toothy smile were all I recognized from photographs. This was at Jacob's Pillow. She had a lady with her, a companion or aide, only a few years younger, who also wore black. This was almost certainly her daughter, Irina Nijinska. Together, the two shuffled in and out of the theater so that Nijinska could smoke. Although Croce calls Les Noces a monument of 20th century art and the greatest work ever created by a woman for a ballet company, it doesn't keep her from cutting its choreographer down to size by ridiculing her aging body. Nijinska, by birth and inclination, belonged to the tribe of working ballet artists. Here her loyalties lay, and she made her successive homes in studios where dancers began the day with pliés and ended it dripping with sweat from hours of rehearsal. High life didn't answer, it didn't interest her, or the fancy dress parties where Serge Lifar once made his entrance on a white horse and on another occasion impersonated Vestris. Yeah, it's true. That was Paris in the 30s. She valued culture, but for the most part avoided intellectuals. Dancers were her family, the recipients of her generosity as a teacher, friend, coach, choreographer, and mentor. Like Frederick Ashton, whom she took under her wing in the Rubinstein Company, and Annette de Valois, on whom she staged her own role in Les Biches as a kind of choreographic practicum, many responded with warm expressions of gratitude. Alexandra Danileva, who worked closely with her in the 1930s, learned one of the most valuable lessons of her career from Nijinska. "She taught me how to act with my body," she wrote. "A great actress expresses what she's feeling with her body and her voice, not by making monkey faces, and Nijinska helped me find that expression in dance." At the same time, Danileva, like so many others who crossed paths with Nijinska in the 1930s and 40s, made a mantra of her shortcomings. She was unattractive, even if she, quote, could submerge herself so deeply in the role which she was portraying that she contrived to assume actual beauty while dancing, end quote. She was demanding. No talking was allowed in rehearsals. No sewing point shoes. Everybody had to pay attention. She was also eccentric. She wore white gloves, which made the dancers feel, as Danileva colorfully put it, as if we all had leprosy. This idiosyncrasy, which Nijinska almost certainly picked up from the exceptionally fastidious Ida Rubinstein, is mentioned again and again as proof of her oddball character, a reason not to take her seriously. Irina Baranova, one of the de Basile's company's baby ballerinas, mentioned it as a matter of course when she came to write her memoirs, while noting, unsurprisingly, the choreographer's unappealing physical appearance and personality. Nijinska was small and broad, Baranova wrote, sort of 4x4. Everyone's into this 4x4, the squareness. She wore a severe black suit over a white shirt, her mousy hair flat over her ears and secured in a tiny bun at the back of her head. She had a broad face, slightly slanty eyes and full lips. Her black expression, as I was introduced to her, was very off-putting. Once they began rehearsing Les Cent Baisers, or The 100 Kisses, Baranova warmed to the older woman. "It was an inspiration to watch Nijinska demonstrate," she wrote. This now is Nijinska in the mid-1930s. She had just stopped dancing. "Her movements were so expressive. She was so wrapped up in her vision of what she wanted. We worked in a friendly, happy atmosphere. All aloofness was gone. She emerged as a lovely human being. Eccentric, yes, but wonderful to work with." Tamara Finch, another de Basile semi-baby ballerina, never discovered that lovely human being. Dispatched with seven other dancers to fill out Nijinska's company, which was fulfilling a de Basile engagement in Monte Carlo while the main troupe was touring the United States, she found Nijinska hateful and rehearsals a torture. She made the most insulting, most humiliating remarks, Finch later wrote, and insisted the new dancers rehearse on point, even when her old dancers wore soft shoes. Quote, she kept us on our toes out of sheer fear. We could not deny that the precision of her work, clear and accurate, the brilliant way she instructed us in a class, could only improve our standard. But during many rehearsals, tears had to be swallowed and lips bitten hard. Her severity was fierce, but we had no alternative but to get on with the season and try to forget the insults. Later, when Nijinska was engaged by the Ballets Russes, Finch and the others became her girls, always in the front row, models for the other dancers to follow. But the damage had been done. For the young generation of emigre dancers, many of whom had yet to reach their 20th birthday, Nijinska was old, ill-tempered, and witch-like. Lydia Sokolova, who danced for Diaghilev in the 1920s, never discovered that lovely human being either, although the two were closer in age and experience. Born Hilda Munnings, Sokolova took over many of Nijinska's roles during World War I, that is when Nijinska went back to Russia. Then when she left the company in 1922, Nijinska reclaimed them while adding to her own repertory roles originally choreographed for Sokolova. Then when Sokolova returned to the company a year later, she took back her own roles, her old roles, but now she had to share them. In dance companies, this is a sure recipe for discontent. And no doubt the source, albeit unacknowledged, of Sokolova's peevish recollections of Nijinska as written years later by Richard Buckle. And I quote from these. Bronislawa Nijinska, known as Bronya, was very like her brother Vaslav Nijinsky. She was blonde and wore her straight hair screwed into a tight little roll. She had pale eyes and pouting lips, wore no makeup at all, and had not shaved off her eyebrows as most of us had in those days. This was the 1920s. In appearance, she was a most unfeminine woman, although there was nothing particularly masculine about her character. Thin but immensely strong, she had iron muscles in her arms and legs, and her highly developed calf muscles resembled Vaslav's. She had the same way of jumping and pausing in the air. Bronya was obstinate, and once she had made up her mind, nothing in the world would move her. She was brilliantly clever and inventive. No music seemed to present any difficulties for her, but her style of movement was even more idiosyncratic than that of Massine, and she was not an easy person to work for in class or at rehearsal. If you excelled in interpreting her strange movements, you got on very well, but a number of us, including myself, did not take to them easily. Strength, masculinity, ugliness, and drive. It was a daunting combination, hardly unusual in men, but one that men, for the most part, found hard to take in a woman. During a rehearsal of Les Biches, Anatole Vilsack recalled, when he was having difficulty in a lift, Nijinska, quote, became so angry at my inadequacy, he's telling this in an oral history in the 1970s, so hence the word like inadequacy, that she lifted and carried Vera Nemchinova for me. I saved face by applauding her. Frederick Franklin, a British dancer and ballet master who encountered her in the late 1930s, was considerably more ambivalent about her qualities than Vilsack. Quote, I was in a ballet company that was run by Alicia Markova and Anton Dolin, he recounted in the 1980s at a symposium of dancers who had worked with Nijinska. And we heard that this very famous lady, La Nijinska, if you please, was coming to see us and maybe do the ballet. She came in the door and she was wearing a white smock and navy blue trousers and white kid gloves. The next thing we were doing Les Biches. First it was, would all the boys go to one side and all the ladies go to the other? Then she said, of course through her husband, who frequently acted as her interpreter, I don't want any newspapers in this room. I don't want any knitting. If I'm not interesting enough to watch while I'm doing my ballets, go out. Well, of course, nobody dared leave. She had also come to help with some of the repertory. We were doing the last act of Nutcracker, and I was doing the Trepak as a solo. We started, and 1 hour and 2 pairs of boots later, we finished. I don't know how. the company around about were looking at me. I sort of fake died, but do you think it was over? No, once more, do it once more. This is what we went through. Of course, I was really terrified of her. At some point, of course, she had also said, I can make a Russian dancer of him. John Taras, who was responsible for rehearsing Nijinska's ballets in the Marquis de Cuevas company during the 1950s, hated her. I was working my ass off, he told the former Cuevas dancer Tena Elg in 1992. She was a very difficult woman to work with. She was jealous. She criticized everything that anyone was doing, end quote. Clearly, Nijinska made some men feel inadequate, and some of those men exploded with rage. Seldom, if ever, in these or other accounts, is there any acknowledgement of the role gender played in the conduct of Nijinska's professional life. Yet her career was surely influenced, to borrow from the art historian Anne Middleton Wagner, by one central circumstance, the fact that she was a woman. In Kiev, where Nijinska had created her first abstract works, she had been an Amazon of the early Soviet avant-garde, a, quote, compassionate, responsive, and smart mother, as a student from her school of movement described her. Emigration transformed her. A woman in a man's job, she learned to be ruthless. She gave few interviews and trusted only her immediate family and circle of intimates. Again and again, she had to prove herself, and the carapace she developed was partly a response to the misogyny she encountered in the upper echelons of the ballet world and among many critics. In the 1930 Opera Brus à Paris souvenir program, there are several photos of Nijinska with the company's creative and administrative personnel. In one, she appears with Michel Fokin. Well, you can see they have the names there. And the designers Ivan Bilibin, Boris Belinsky, and Alexandre Benoit. In another, a studio photograph, or a photograph taken in with the dance company, she appears with the director Nikolai Ivrenov, the conductor Michel Steinman, and the company's animateurs, Prince Alexis Ceritelli and Colonel Vasily de Bazile, Ceritelli's second in command, an all boys network, of course, although like Nijinska, they were all scrambling for a place in a tanking economy. Remember, this is 1930, the Depression. But it wasn't only outside the studio that enemies lurked. They were in every corner of the dance world. Choreographic competitors like Balanchine in the middle, Massine, when you see who that is, and Boris Romanov, Boris Knasiev, Konstantin Cherkas, Serge Lifar, her former pupil, whom you see in Fawn, who wrote scurrilously in his 1935 memoir, Du temps que j'avais faim, and made sure she never worked at the Paris Opera again. She had worked there periodically during the late 1920s. As for Colonel de Bazile, in 1931, he effectively hijacked the company that Nijinska had built, offering its dancers repertory and properties to René Blum as a nucleus of what became the Ballets Russes de Monte Carlo, enlisting Diaghilev's former secretary, Boris Kokhnov, with whom Nijinska had often clashed as artistic advisor, and Balanchine as maître du ballet. One didn't have to be paranoid, and Nijinska was certainly a little bit paranoid, to see plots everywhere. Nijinska's contemporaries accepted women as teachers, performers, rehearsal directors, and coaches in the professional ballet world. They accepted them as choreographers for modern dance and of ballets for the popular stage. What they could not accept was a woman holding creative sway on the preeminent stages of high modernism, defined in the first half of the 20th century as Diaghilev's Ballets Russes and its successors. Diaghilev's desperate need for a choreographer in 1921 led him to overlook Nijinska's sex, but it did not keep him or later generations of writers, critics, and dancers from ascribing her gifts to the genes she shared with her brother, while using her eccentricities of character and appearance to belittle her as an artist and minimize her historical importance. Victoria Fortuna, a young scholar, in an article about the Teatro Colón in a recent issue of Dance Research Journal, this is the American Dance Research Journal, inexplicably omits Nijinska's name from a list of works on Argentine subjects, although Nijinska's 1926 Quadro Campestre was the first such work on the Colón stage. This kind of semi-erasure had implications not only for Nijinska's own career, but also for other women who forged choreographic careers in her wake. To an even greater degree than Nijinska, they became links in a broken chain of succession. Their works all but eradicated from ballet's canon of memory, members of a tradition that exists only as fragments, whispers, and echoes. Thank you. Yes, I can stand. I'll probably sway, which I always do.
Could I just ask if people wait for the microphone to come around when they if they want to ask a question? Anybody want to kick off? Thank you.
Thank you for a fantastic talk. It's revelatory research into a key figure in Russian modernism, if we can speak of her in terms of Russian modernism. Did she have a relationship with other Amazons of the avant-garde, like Goncharova?
She did have a relationship
with
Goncharova.
Were they supportive?
I would say her relationship with Exter, Alexandra Exter, at a certain moment was extremely influential. She met her probably in 1916, 1917, possibly in Kiev, but certainly in Moscow, where Exter was working for the Chamber Bag Kamerny Theater. They're doing some of her very very innovative productions. They then and Nijinska actually remained in Moscow for several months, and wrote a treatise, and this which was never published. But the draft of that treatise is extremely interesting because you can see the impact of modernism. There are also very interesting things, and then they remained in touch when Nijinska returned to Kiev. Exter remained in Kiev for a while, but then she left for Odessa and other places, went back to Kiev. As you know, Kiev changed sides during the Civil War and Revolutionary period something like 17 or 18 times. At various points, Exter went back, and they worked together. And the designs I showed you by Meller was a part of Exter's sort of studio and group of people who gathered at her studio. So there was certainly that connection. The Goncharova connection, I would say, is more of a friendship connection. Goncharova designed Les Noces for her, and Goncharova and Larionov were part of Nijinska's group of friends. But I don't think there was that aesthetically transformative relationship. Now it is clear, it seems pretty clear, that the look of Les Noces, the plainness, the spareness of it, was very much Nijinska's. And she said, this is the only ballet that Diaghilev allowed a choreographer, in a sense, to control the presentation. But that was Nijinska's designs for that went through something like five, there are numerous variations, beginning from the war years, very highly operatic. And Nijinska simply did not want to use, she saw it very differently. But then, of course, she saw the designs after having heard the music, Stravinsky's music. So she was responding, I think, really to the music, and she wanted something as unintrusive as possible. Later, Nijinska worked with Goncharova. She had her remake certain sets of designs for ballets that Nijinska had originally done for Ida Rubinstein, and certainly there was a great deal of respect, but I don't think there was this catalytic relationship that she had with Ekster.
For such a brilliant choreographer, it's fairly shocking that I think it's just three works remain by her. Is that right? And I'm wondering, first of all, if you could explain how this came about. But also, I'm wondering if there are any other works that could be perhaps reconstructed in some way.
The unfortunate thing is that once something goes out of performance for a very, very long time, it's very difficult to bring it back. There were a couple of attempts by the Oakland Ballet, working with someone who had danced with Nijinska in the 1930s and 40s, and to bring back her bolero, but I'm not sure that it was enormously successful. I think what we're seeing with Le Train Bleu is really more Frank Rees than Bronislawa Nijinska, although there are certainly hints of it. It's very difficult. The Baiser de la Fée, I don't know, although even in the 1940s, when Balanchine brought his Baiser de la Fée and set it on the Paris Opera in 1947, I think it was, there were critics who had remembered the original Eva Rubinstein production and said that the scene in the town, the Tyrolean dances, that was all the rhythmic complexity. They remembered that from Nijinska's version. But I don't think it would be possible to bring that back. And also, it's a flawed ballet in many respects. And it's one that certainly Balanchine went back to again and again and again and kept trying to get right and never quite managed to it, although there were sections that were really quite brilliant. So I'm not certain that there's much that could be really brought back. I think the important thing is to keep the two in repertory, and Les Noces and Les Biches. And the difficulty is, for Biches, you have to have a sophisticated group of dancers. I've seen it done not so long ago on an American company, and they just didn't seem to have a clue what they were doing. What this was really about. And Les Noces is also difficult. It requires a full musical complement, it requires a very large company, and it requires lots and lots of hours of rehearsal to get everyone together. And even, I've seen some performances at the Royal where some of the corps were really not as together as they should have been, and that's the Royal, a very fine company. So and at the Paris Opera, nothing ever seems to stay in repertory. There are programs, and maybe a program will be revised, but there's not an active repertory that, where something, really comes back. So it's a difficult problem. At this point, I think the keeping things in good repair at the Royal is a way of keeping things in good repair.
Did Frederick Ashton have more positive comments to make
about Nijinska? Oh, absolutely. That's why I added that he always acknowledged her influence on him. She really allowed him to sit in when she was choreographing in the studio, and she was someone who really felt the studio was a place for working, and she only wanted the dancers, no newspapers, no knitting. But she allowed him to sit and watch everything he wanted to watch. She sensed in him, as I think she must have sensed in Davalwa, a choreographer in the making, and very you know, there, and of course she was deeply, deeply grateful to him for bringing Les Biches back and for bringing Les Noces back. And the letters are very, very sweet. Another one for whom there's a great deal of correspondence was Anton Dolin. This kind of surprised me. I mean, letters that went on and on, you'd see even a few words of Russian transliterated, misspelled by Dolin, trying them out. But deeply, you know, deeply grateful. And he wrote to her in French. She wrote to him in French, you know, this. But Ashton was always, you know, absolutely grateful to him. So he's completely different. That's why I added that at the end. I think this.
Hi, I've actually got two questions, but mm-hmm. they're fairly short, I hope. The first one, do you think she was responsible for changing the way people viewed women with artistic sway, as you called it, or do you think she didn't manage that because she still faced so much kind of criticism and opposition?
I don't think she actually made that much difference. I think the fact that she kept working and working and working meant that there was a woman working. But I do think there was a certain amount of personal influence on someone like de Valois. After all, it's de Valois, in a sense, she served her choreographic apprenticeship, if you will, with Nijinska. So I think that's an influence. But de Valois was not someone who on her own necessarily promoted women choreographers, and indeed she gave up her own choreographic career, which was quite successful in the late 20s and 1930s, in order to focus on being the artistic director of what had clearly become a major institution. So she, as the director, in a sense, outweighed the choreographer. And I think she didn't, because the institution got so big, I don't think she was particularly interested in promoting women or doing what needed to be done for women to be promoted as choreographers.
Okay. And my second question, do you think her sort of Russianness, her nationality, had an impact on her work or her way of doing things, or I guess the history that she lived through in Russia, or do you think it was sort of other factors?
Oh, I think it was enormously important being Russian, enormously important. I don't, I mean, first of all, she wrote and wrote and wrote and wrote, I mean, boxes of stuff, all in Russian. I mean, occasionally there'll be a letter in French, but her speech was Russian. I think the way she worked with dancers was very much part of this emigre world of people who were fairly desperate. There's another part of one of the reviews that I've, where Levinson is going after her about all kinds of things. But then there's one part where he says, how could this group of dancers whose lives have been so insecure, these emigres, they're living as refugees in this company, and here they are becoming a company. Who is this dictator who is responsible? And he said, despite everything with Nijinska, I must commend what she has done with this. This is incredible. But they were willing to do whatever it took, in a sense, to get beyond, to get out of their current situation. And very clearly, ballet was one way of doing it. So the emigre magazines, not that I've poured through many of them, but I have gone through some, it's just filled with photographs of little girls from intelligentsia backgrounds, and sometimes you recognize the names, they're fairly well-to-do names, who are all in their tutus studying with so-and-so, and there's a recital by so-and-so. And even if you think of the baby ballerinas, none of them came from modest backgrounds. Ryobushinska came from one of the wealthiest families in the Russian Empire. So you had this whole other you know, a group of people who before would never have studied ballet, never, you know, thought of becoming professional ballet dancers, now entering that. I also think there, she did a great deal of the work she did was for these emigre companies. And so I think in some measure that actually limited her a little bit, because it meant that much of the work she was doing was to Russian, where the ballets that were part of the Russian musical repertoire. I mean, it's a rich repertoire, but nevertheless, it limits you a little bit. I'd love to have seen her do, she did one other piece to Poulenc. Poulenc loved it, he wrote about it in many letters, but I would have liked to have seen that side of her develop a little bit more, the way she took a chance on Pomona, which they didn't like much in Buenos Aires, but she took a chance on it. And it would be, but I think because of her affiliation and her being part of the emigre community, she was somewhat limited. But of course, that is one of the problems of being an emigre. Where is your culture in the future going to lie? And I think one of the things Diaghilev did in the very last years with people like Balanchine and Boris Kokhno and others was, in a sense, to create a place for them to be modernist, creative people outside, you know, both inside but also outside the emigre community, which was not something that Nijinska really found. She continued to be doing things that traded in some measure on her Russian connection. Even in the US, she worked with a ballet theater in the very early years, now American Ballet Theater, with the Ballets Russes de Monte Carlo, for Ballet International, which later became the De Cuevas Company. But she becomes then really a link back to the Ballets Russes and revives many of the works. So it was enormously important for her.
Thank you.
I think some things have changed. But I think the nakedness, that one, reading some of that, one understands the nakedness of some of the problems. I mean, imagine if you read the Russian emigre newspapers and you've just done Les Noces and you open it up and you read some of what Levinson is writing.
Yes, and in fact, in Britain, it was completely slammed, wasn't it, in 1926?
In 26. No,
thank
God for, I mean, that's where I say that, he, you know, and she was enormously cognizant of the debt she owed him. And she was still in touch. She was sent, you know, Chernichova was still living here. And she and Nijinska would correspond, and Nijinska would want to know, well, how did it look when you went to see it last week? Or Sunny, she said, oh, it looked very good, and this was this, or maybe it should be a little bit more. And she was in touch with some of the English dancers about, because she was so anxious for this to stay in repertory, because she had spent a number of years setting things, going from one company to another company, in the hope of keeping these things alive. And then, you know, the director would change, and you know, this happens all the time. The director changes, and out goes one repertory, in comes a new one, you know. So she was deeply cognizant. And the other thing she spent is her last year, again, to secure her legacy. We've been hearing a lot about that lately. Her legacy was this manuscript called My Brother Vatsa. Almost as though, which then after many editions and a fair amount of editing, not all of which some of which actually shocks me, but in any event, she then becomes early memoirs. But my brother Vlad said it's almost as though she had come to the, if they're going to call me Nijinsky's sister, well, I'm going to say my brother Vatsa. And if that's going to be the way I place myself at the center, then that's what I will do. And she did. Well, she had to be.
Anyway, Lynn, thank you so much for this wonderfully illuminating talk. And we know that this is going to put Bronislawa Nijinska on the map.
Yes.
Thank you.